Good morning. Good to see everyone here today. Shall we join together in the call to worship as it's printed in your bulletin? You are the Lord. Let the peoples tremble. You sit enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. You are exalted over all the peoples. Hear us as we praise your great and awesome name. You indeed are holy. Lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. We will extol you, O Lord our God, and worship at your footstool. Let us worship God. All our lives are full of your mercy, O God. Wherever we turn, you are sure to be there. If we are found in the depths of depression, you lift up our spirits with the hope of new life. When we bound to the heights of ecstasy, you rejoice with us and make our feet light. You surround us with your Spirit, who knows our needs before we announce them. We give you all praise, O God of life. Shall we join together in our hymn number 793? We join together in the prayer of confession as it is in your bulletin. Lover of justice, distinctions become blurred when we are called on to serve you. We have been taught that you serve is to obey you. At times, fidelity to others gets in our way. Societal pressures appeal to that sense of security that speaks to our welfare. Mores and customs become mandates. Higher loyalties are put aside. We confess our mixed allegiance. Have mercy upon us as we face obligations, and reclaim us from error when we obey not your will. Remember the words of the prophet Jeremiah when he wrote, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will put my law within them, and I will write it upon their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Therein lies our assurance. One another in peace.
Children's message. I do want to remind you, we are having Sunday school, and all of our children, our youth, are welcome to come. We have class for, I believe it's sixth grade and up with Mrs. Shibley, and then the fifth grade and down will go to Sunday school with myself and Olivia. So we remind you to come. If you have grandchildren or children, bring them. We are practicing social distancing and doing the very best we can to keep everything sanitized and clean, but we do want you to come and know that that option is still available. And the other thing I want to do is I want to thank the people, Jackie in particular, who have been providing us with special music each week. I know we really miss the choir. I miss singing in choir. I know Mrs. Volick misses singing in choir. We all miss it. But without that music, the service seems to lack something. So we should be very grateful that each week Jackie and this week Alicia is accompanying her, that they've gone out of their way to kind of bring us that element of worship that is so meaningful and brings something so special to the service. So when you get a chance, do tell them thank you, because that's something they've gone out of their way to do. Now I want to get on to the children's message. This week, Pastor Mark's going to be referring to our New Testament lesson, and the key verse in that is, "Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and unto God what is God's." And in Sunday school today, we're going to be talking a lot about what belongs to God, and the kids are going to get a handout that looks like this with a big question mark on it. What belongs to God? And it really brings up an interesting question, because we have to spend each and every day wondering about our values and wondering what belongs to God. What should I be rendering to God that pleases God? And the obvious question is, answer is everything. So let's narrow it down to what is the one thing that is one of the most important things we can give to God, something that's non-renewable. We get it one time, and if we misuse it or misplace it, it's gone forever. We can never recoup it. But we keep getting new ones in its own way, and that's your time. And I want to remind you that all these other things in the world, trees and money and friendships and family, they come and go. You know, that's how life is. But our time, we get one precious moment given to us at a time. It's our present from God for us to give back to God. So when we start thinking about what belongs to God more than anything else is our time and how we choose to spend that time. And that's what I'm hoping to convey to the children today in Sunday school, is how important each and every moment of life truly is, and what a blessing it is to have life and to live in a country as great and wonderful as the United States, where we can have the freedoms and the liberties to use that time to God's glory each and every day. Let us pray. Lord, we are so grateful that you give us time, and that you give us one moment at a time that we can make decisions on how we're going to share it, how we're going to use it, and how we're going to use it particularly to love and worship you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture text today comes from Exodus chapter 33, starting in verse 12. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you have said to me, 'Bring up this people,' but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, 'I know you by name,' and you have also found favor in my sight. Now if I have found favor in your sight, show me your ways, so I may know you and find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." He said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go with us, do not carry us up from here. For how shall it be known that I found favor in your sight, I and your people, unless you go with us? In this way we shall be distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth. The Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing that you have asked, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name. Moses said, show me your glory, I pray. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and will proclaim before you the name, the Lord, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I shall mercy. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live. And the Lord continued, see, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face you shall not see. Our New Testament lesson today comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, starting at verse 1. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and the mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith in labor of love and steadfast hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. For you know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you, not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report to us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is to come. Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, starting at verse 15. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax. And they brought him the denarius. Then he said to them, Whose head is this, and whose title? They answered, Caesar's. Then he said to them, Give therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have a presidential election coming up. I'm sure all of you know that. And boy, have elections changed over the years. There was a time I can remember when United States senators and congresspeople basically campaigned 3 or 4 months out of the election. It was a very short election cycle. Even the presidential election cycle was short. Things didn't usually get revved up until after the Democratic or Republican conventions. But today, if you want to be president, you have to campaign the entire year of the election, and not just that year, the year before, to get yourself situated in the right place in the primaries. And then there are people who even campaign a year before that. And today, our United States senators and congresspeople, everything they do, everything they say, every appearance they have, everything they do is with an eye towards the next election in a year, 2 years, 4 years, or 6 years. Our national figures are now constantly campaigning for office. And boy, what a change it has made in our body politics. Add to this the changes in multimedia. There are more ways for campaigns to get their messages out today so that we're inundated with them than there ever were before. You add to that the 24-hour news cycle, and it's very difficult today to get away from our body politic, to get away from the fact that we have elections and that our representatives, our senators, our presidents are always campaigning and always running. The multimedia has also added another dimension where every campaign seeks to find that soundbite so that they can characterize the opposing individual. And they can use that in all their multimedia. And for themselves, they want some slogan, a slogan that resonates with people. So again, they can put that in all of their media. And so we get inundated with these sound bites and these slogans. Boy, things have changed with our elections over the years. In our gospel lesson today, the religious leaders believe they have Jesus in a trap. They believe they're about to put him on the horns of a dilemma, and no matter what he does, he is going to be in trouble because they're going to get their soundbite. So they come to him, and boy, did they lay it on thick. "Good teacher," they say, "we know that you have come from God. We know that you teach the way of truth. We know you don't show partiality," meaning you treat everybody equally. "We know you're from God. We know you teach the truth. So, good teacher, should we pay taxes to Caesar? Or should we shouldn't? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar, or is it not?" They believe they have put Jesus on the horns of a dilemma where they're going to get their soundbite. If Jesus says, "Yes, be good citizens and pay your taxes to the emperor," well, that's going to be a soundbite they can use to turn the crowd against him. Now, they wouldn't have multimedia in that day, but still, soundbites could travel by word of mouth as well. And so they could get the crowd to turn against him because as excited as people are to pay taxes to their own nation, they're even less excited to pay taxes to foreign nations who are occupying forces. No Jewish person wanted to pay taxes to the emperor. So they're hoping Jesus will either say, "Yes, pay taxes," in which they've got their soundbite, or if Jesus takes the other position and says, "No, we shouldn't pay tax to Caesar," they still have their soundbite. But it's not to the crowd they're going to take that soundbite, but to the Romans. There were very few things that caused or provoked a violent response from Rome more than an individual telling a crowd, "We don't need to pay taxes to Caesar." So they think they have Jesus on the horns of the dilemma. No matter how he answers this question, they are going to have their soundbite to use against him. Jesus looks at them and says, "Why are you trying to trick me?" And then he asks for a coin. And so they give him the coin. And he says, "Whose likeness is on this?" And they say, "Caesar's." And he says, "Then render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar, and to God's the thing that are God's." And it says they go away amazed. They cannot believe that he got out of this trap. They cannot believe he escaped the soundbite that they thought they were going to have to use against him. But that brings up an interesting question. Why were the religious leaders so surprised that Jesus evaded this trap? Why did they think there were only two possible answers to this question? Why didn't they imagine that there could be a third answer or maybe even more answers to this question? Why were they sure Jesus had to answer one way or another? They believed something about the Messiah. And Jesus had been claiming to be the Messiah, and more than that, the Son of God. They knew this. And they knew something very important about this Messiah. And one of the most important things about the Messiah they just knew is that when the Messiah came, the Messiah was going to institute a new body politics. The rule and reign of God over not just Israel, but all people. Now, this was not a new thing. What they saw this as a restoration of what once was, what was in the beginning where God reigned over humanity. But all other groups and peoples had abandoned that so long ago that it's not even recorded in our ancient histories. But there was one group of people that stubbornly clung to that form of government, and that was the Israelites. And we see this in our Old Testament lesson today from Exodus. It is Moses who's leading the people out of Egypt. It is Moses who's performing these miracles. It's Moses who's giving the law. But we know it's not Moses. It's God. God called Moses. God gave Moses the power to do those miracles. God gave the laws to Moses to give to the people to organize them. The Israelites are seeking to have God as their king, to be reigned and ruled over by God. They stubbornly clung to that form of government for a long, long time. But even they decided eventually that they didn't want that form of government. About 1,000 years before Jesus' time, about 3,000 before our time today, they decided they wanted to be like every other nation. They wanted to have a king. And so when they got a king, the absolute last shred where God was king over the people was lost to the world. And from that moment on, every nation, every people was ruled by other people, by other forms of government, by other societies, by other ways of organizing and structuring people made by human beings. All of that was lost. And so after that, the body politics where human beings organize governments and reign and rule over other people was the only thing that was left on our earth. And the reason, getting back to those religious leaders, they believe there's only two answers possible for Jesus is because they just know one of the most important things the Messiah is going to do is to institute that reign and that rule of God, not just over Israel, but the world. And so surely if Jesus is the Messiah, he has to have an opinion about this. If he is the Messiah, if he's the Son of God, he has to have an opinion about the forms of government in his day. He can't simply sidestep that question. He has to take a stand. It was the same thing his apostles and disciples would have believed, or anyone in the crowd. They would have all expected that he had to take a stand because as the Messiah, he had to institute the new form of government where God reigned and ruled. The thing was, Jesus understood his ministry and mission a little bit better than the religious leaders and his apostles and disciples and the crowd. And he knew he was not there to save our governments. He knew he did not come to teach so that our governments could be preserved for all time. He did not come to die so our sins of our governments could be forgiven so that they could continue on and on and on. He didn't come to save our political orders. He came to save people. He came to save souls. He came to forgive the sins of an individual so that individual had the opportunity to live on and on and on. Jesus could avoid this trap because he knew that his ministry and mission had nothing whatsoever to do with commenting on Rome or the Caesars or Herod or any other form of government in his day. It simply wasn't important to him. We do have a presidential election coming up, and there's a lot of fear, there's a lot of doubt, there's a lot of uncertainty around that election. And there's good reason for that. The Bible tells us something very important about human forms of government, and it's the same message, whether it's from the prophets, whether it's from Jesus, whether it's from the apostles. The Bible has the same message about human governments. And it tells us, unlike the optimistic, futuristic worldviews where nations get together and live in peace and work together to feed and clothe and shelter people and work together so that each individual has dignity, each individual has rights, each individual can obtain his or her abilities in life. No, the Bible says human forms of government are in fact doomed. Whether it's any of the prophets in the Old Testament, Jesus in the Gospels, the apostles, every word that the Bible speaks about human forms of government is that one day it is doomed. There is a reason we should have some fear and doubt and uncertainty heading towards an election, because the Bible tells us someday our governments are going to turn on us. They're going to turn on us and they're going to seek to devour us. They're going to turn on humanity and they're going to turn against God and what is right and what is just and what is true. And Jesus says that happens at least in the last days, if not sooner. So what are we to do? If the Bible has told us that at some unspecified time, our governments are going to turn against us, what are we to do with the governments we find ourselves under? Well, the Thessalonians in our scripture text today have a lot to teach us. Our epistle lesson has a whole lot to teach us about that. The Thessalonians are spoken of as a people who had joy and who had happiness in their lives. And yet we know, as a fact, the government that the Thessalonians lived under was far more unjust, far more evil, by orders of magnitude, than any administration that America's ever had. And I know that's difficult because both political parties get together and lob accusations about the other person's or the other party's administration and how bad it was. But if you go back and you look at the government that the Thessalonians were living under, it was orders of magnitude more unjust and more evil than anything that we've lived under. And yet they had joy. They had happiness. They had purpose. They had meaning in life. How is such a thing even possible? Well, the thing the Thessalonians knew, which they could teach us today, is that they understood that their meaning and their purpose and their very identity was not bound up in whatever governmental structure was over them. It wasn't bound up in whatever government system they found them under themselves with. It wasn't bound up in that at all. And that was important because they lived under a government that could take away all of their freedoms in a blink of an eye. Just because they were believers, they could be thrown in prison, they could be sold into slavery, they could be killed. Just because they believed. And yet they still found joy and happiness because they knew their identity and their eternal salvation and what was ultimately meaningful in life wasn't bound up in the government that was reigning over them, but in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. That's where they found their meaning. That's where they found their value. That's where they found their purpose. And as such, they could find peace even under such a government. Not only do the Thessalonians have a lot to teach us about where our meaning and purpose and value comes from, they also have a lot to teach us about how to react and how to live in the world. It tells us not only were they filled with joy and hope and faith, which is all wonderful and good, but they were also filled with good works. They were indeed exactly what Jesus called them to be. A light in the world. They were exactly what Jesus called them to be, examples of how he would have them live in the world. In the midst of a government that was so unjust, in the midst of sin that was so permeating in the society, they stood forth in the call they had in Jesus Christ to be a light to what was right and just and true. They stood forth and were faithful in serving in all the ways that Jesus asked them to serve, even in that situation. The Thessalonians have so much to teach us in our scripture text today. We have allowed ourselves to be filled with fear and anxiety. We have allowed ourselves to be dragged into emotional issues. We have allowed ourselves to be dragged off of our core and off of our center, where our value and our meaning is in life. And because of that, we have stressed ourselves out and been filled with anxiety. But if we will learn like those Thessalonians, where our meaning and value comes from, then the peace can come that passes all understanding. Then the joy can come that can never be taken away. The understanding that we have an eternal call in Jesus Christ can be ours. And that is far more important than whatever form of government we find ourselves under. But that doesn't mean that we cloister. That doesn't mean we separate from the world, because that's not what the Thessalonians did. The Thessalonians stood for what they knew was true and just. And so, yes, if we believe one political party is going to bring better things for someone, then we should be voting and supporting for them. If we believe a candidate is going to make things better for individuals, they'll have more liberties and freedoms, then we should support them. If there are organizations and groups that we think are working for the good things that God wants for people, yes, we should support them. We should be lights in those situations. We should be serving as Jesus has commanded us, to be examples in the world. But we should always remember that in that work, just as the Thessalonians remembered the work they were doing in the world, that's not where their value came from. That's not where their meaning came from. That's not where their center came from. It was in the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. If we remember that, if we hold on to that, if we claim that in his name, then whatever form of government we find ourselves in, we can have peace. And when we see a government that we want to fight for, when we see a candidate we think is going to make people's lives better, then that is precisely the time to stand forth and to stand up for them. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and helping us to understand what you have asked us to do. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Join me in the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Any announcements? Any prayer requests? Is anybody awake? No? No? All right, then let us gather together as people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for all the blessings that you have given us, the blessings of living in a time and a place where we do have so many freedoms. And we pray, Lord God, that you will bless us in this time, reminding us that in amidst these freedoms, which are wonderful and amazing and worth fighting for, they are still not our identity. They're still not as what is ultimately of value. And that is, we find those things in you. We find our rest in you. We find our peace in you. We find our comfort in you. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us so that we can be lights in the world, so that we can be faithful servants in wherever we find ourselves, in whatever situation, whether we're working with individuals or whether we feel like individuals are fighting against us, whether we feel like we're going with the wind or it's blowing against us. By your Spirit, enable us to understand that what is important is the work that you have for us to do. What is important is your will. What is important is standing forth for what is true and just and right. Please, Lord God, help us through your Spirit to understand that it is the effort and the work and not the outcomes that are the most important thing to you. We pray this time, Lord God, for our nation. We have enjoyed a lot of freedoms and liberties. And we have enjoyed a lot of unity as a nation in our past. We pray, Lord God, that you would continue to bless us so that we can be a nation of freedom and liberties, a nation that encourages individuals to find their passions and to be able to reach their potential, a nation that encourages individuals to dream and to think of what might be. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will continue to bless us as a country and enable us to have such a wonderful experience in this world under political systems. We also pray this day, Lord God, for all of those who are running for office, all those who are currently holding office. We pray that you'll bless them with your spirit and your knowledge and your wisdom so that they can live up to the great heritage they have received in our country. And they can move forward in a world putting forth a government that will help its people. We also pray this day, Lord God, for all of our brothers and sisters around the world who are under situations where they don't have freedoms and liberties and where they have been oppressed and killed. We remember not only those today, but all those down throughout history who have lived under such situations. And we pray, Lord God, that your spirit will be with them, because we know that with your promises and with your Holy Spirit, you can give them comfort and peace as you did those in the early Christian church. You can give them the understanding that you are with them in a very special way, as the Thessalonians knew so long ago. We pray, Lord God, that you will be with them for the difficult situations you've called them to be lights in very dark places, and called them to be faithful in places where it is so easy to give up hope and faith. We pray, Lord, that your spirit and presence will be with them and that you will guide them. We also pray this day, Lord God, for all those that we know that are going through difficulties and struggles. We pray that your spirit and presence will be with them, that you will guide them, and that you will give them comfort. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
May we then live
Join me in the prayer of dedication. Oh God, we hear about the cost of discipleship. Nothing less than our whole life is required. We dedicate these gifts in response to Christ's call and offer ourselves in full commitment. Take us and mold us according to His will. We pray that who we may be acceptable, what we may do find favor, and that which we give will reflect Your love. Amen. Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and give grace upon you. And may He lift His countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.